I welcome all my students. So welcome, friends. Today's session I'm going to take on the very basic topic of the ophthalmology. Ophthalmology, the basic thing we should know is it works like the main purpose in ophthalmology of the eye is to see, is to visualize the thing. And to visualize the thing, we should know basically how the optics of the eye works. So I'm going to start from the basic topic of optics. So let me from Dr. A.K. Jain, these are the books you can refer. First thing we are going to do is eye as a camera. What are the eye components? What do we mean by schematic and reduced eyes? What are the visual axis and visual angles? Optical defects of the eye. These will be our headings under which we are going to understand the optics of eye. So let us compare the eye with a routine camera. What we all have in with us, a routine camera. The parts of routine camera are basically film, dark chamber, lens, focusing ring, diaphragm, aperture, shutter of the cap, shutter cap of the camera. So when we compare camera with a human eye, the retina is like the film of camera. The pixels are rods and cones of the retina. Dark chamber is provided by choroid. Lens is like crystalline lens of human eye. We can simulate the focusing ring with the ciliary muscle. And the diaphragm is iris. Iris works as the diaphragm of the eye. The pupil is the aperture, which is the opening in the iris. And eyelids work as the shutter cap. So we can see that the camera, a routine camera, and a human eye, they both have similar kind of comparisons. And as we can see here, that this person's image formed by a camera is diagonally inverse on the film of the camera. Similarly, the image of this person is formed on the retina with inverse image is formed, which is diagonally inverse. So this retina and this camera film, they are comparable to each other. Now, we see the various components of the eye. So because I'm an ophthalmologist, I will not go into the details of the camera component, but I'll go with the components of the eye. So what are the components of the eye? What are the refracting surfaces? And what are the surface where the image is formed? So the components of the eye are cornea, anterior chamber, iris and pupil, crystalline lens, and retina. So we'll take them one by one. We'll see there what are the various properties, what are the various optical properties these all components of the eye have. So we'll go one by one. First, we'll take the cornea. Cornea is the anterior most part of the eyeball. What are the optical special features of cornea? When we deal with the cornea and the corneal pathologies, the coming sections of cornea, that time we'll explain various other things. But here, I'm not touching those parts. I'm just explaining the optical properties of the cornea. So cornea vertical diameter is slightly less than the horizontal diameter just because the pressure of the upper eyelid squeezes the eyeball in a vertical dimension. So the vertical diameter is little less, which is around 11.5 millimeters, whereas the horizontal diameter is around 11.5 to 12 millimeters. Similarly, the front apical radius, if you go into the millimeter, is 7.7 millimeters, and which is equated by in the diopters of the keratometry of the curvature form is 48.83. Similarly, the back apical radius of the cornea is 6.8 millimeter and the curvatural value is minus. See, there is a huge difference between the front apical radius, which is plus 48, and the back apical radius is minus 5.8. So the overall difference in these two curvatures is roughly 53-54 diopters. and the refractive index of the cornea is 1.376. It is a homogeneous refractive index all around the cornea. The refractive power of cornea is 43 diopters. It's around 40 to 43 diopters, which is 2/3 of the total eye refractive power. What are the reasons? So for high corneal refractive power, because of the steep curvature, because of the significant difference in refractive index of the air and cornea, the refractive index of air is 1, whereas the refractive index of cornea is 1.376. Cornea is a single refracting surface with a homogeneous material, and it has got very little thickness. The thickness is around 500 micrometers. So these are the regions the cornea becomes such a strong high corneal refracting surface of the eye. Next component of the eye is anterior chamber. As we can see here, the anterior chamber is nothing but a cavity between this cornea and iris. This blue color shown here is the iris, and this is the cornea. So the cavity in between cornea and iris is called anterior chamber. This anterior chamber is filled with aqueous, and the refractive index of the aqueous humor is 1.336, which is lower than the refractive index of cornea. So these are points. Why I am telling these are points? Because many a times, even in the MBBS or even in the postgraduate exams, these MCQ has been asked. So we have to remember all these values, that what are the refractive power of cornea, refractive index of cornea, which is 1.376. Similarly, the refractive index of aqueous is 1.336. So they confuse in MCQs by giving all the refractive indexes, because later on I am going to tell you about the refractive index of crystalline lens, so which is around 1.41. So what they do is they give all the refractive indexes in the answer, and the students get confused that which one is the correct one, because their mind knows all these refractive indexes are there in the optics. But so how to remember them? So remember them is, I'll tell you when we go for the crystalline lens, I will tell you how to remember these refractive indexes, because they have been asked in MCQ. And what is the depth of the anterior chamber? It is 2.5 to 4 millimeters. The optical importance of the depth is that any change in the anterior chamber depth will influence the refractive power of the eye. If there is 1 millimeter forward lens shift, it will increase about 1.4 diopter power of the eye. It means that if there is a decrease in the depth of the AC or anterior chamber by 1 millimeter, the eye power will increase by 1.4, roughly 1.5 times of the 1.5 diopter more. The next component of the eye is iris and pupil. Iris is mainly, as I told you before, we can compare it as a diaphragm. Diaphragm, the main purpose of a diaphragm in a camera or in a human eye is to control the entry of the light, the amount, how much light is required to have a clear vision. So iris does that part as a diaphragm, and pupil is an opening in the iris. So normal pupillary size, asked many a times, is 2.4 millimeters. It is 2.4 millimeters. So this part, this black part is the pupil, and this entire area, bluish part, is the iris. So if suppose the pupillary size increases or decreases, how this will affect on the optical property of the eye, I will tell you in the coming slides. But here to tell you a reference, if the size, this size of 2.4 millimeter, which is a normal size in a normal light condition, it is the best kind of retinal images are formed, and the abrasions and diffractions are minimized. If the size increases, what will happen on these abrasions, or what will happen on the retinal size or image, I will tell you in the coming slide. The average size of the pupil, as I told you, is between 2 to 4 millimeters in various light conditions. In dark condition, it will it's up to 4 millimeters, but in the daylight, it is 2 millimeters. Small pupil, what will happen if the pupil becomes less than 2 millimeter size, the depth of the focus will increase. And the same concept we use as a pinhole test during the refraction to know that whether the refractive power calculated was accurate or not. So, and the large pupil, when it is more than 4 millimeter, the retinal image quality will improve, but simultaneously the size of the blue circles will also increase. So these blue circles will hamper the retinal images. Crystalline lens, that is the next component of the eye, which is another refracting surface, the first refracting surface of the eye. We learned thus far, which has got nearly 2/3 power of the total refractive power of the eye. And the remaining refractive power of the eye lies with crystalline lens. So this is the second important component, optical component of the eye. Thickness of the crystalline lens, as we can see, there is a variation in the thickness because the thickness of the cornea is very less, very thin, and it remains almost constant after birth, which is, I told you, around 550 micrometers to 600. 500 to 600, some books write, but it is 540 to 550 micrometers. It is not millimeters. So you have to remember, guys, this is not, the corneal thickness is in micrometers, whereas the crystalline lens thickness is in millimeters. So the thickness of the crystalline lens at birth is 3.5 to 4 millimeters. This thickness increases gradually for a period. As the person becomes adult, the thickness goes to 4.75 to 5 millimeters. 5 millimeters is half a centimeter. Radius of curvature, we know the radius of curvature of cornea, anterior and the radius back curvatures. Where posterior anterior was in plus, whereas the back was in minus. Here, the radius of curvature of anterior and posterior surface both are in plus, which is 10 millimeter and 6 millimeter. So, you remember this, the radius of curvature of the lens, crystalline lens, changes drastically during the accommodation. During the accommodation, these radius of curvature, they changes drastically. And that's how the accommodation happens, because of the change in the curvature of the crystalline lens. Similarly, the refractive power of the lens is not homogeneous like cornea. Cornea has a homogeneous refractive index of 1.376 all around, whereas the lens has got different type, different refractive index at different places. The central portion of the lens is nucleus. Basically, the crystalline lens has got two portions, nucleus and cortex. So the power of the refractive index of the nucleus is highest, 1.41, whereas at the poles of the crystalline lens, it is 1.385. And at equator, it is almost same as cornea, which is 1.375. And the total refractive power of the crystalline lens is 18 to 22 diopters. As we learned that the refractive power of the cornea is around 42 to 44, 45 diopters, which is 2/3 and this is 1/3 of the total refractive power of the eye, which is around 60 diopters, 60 to 62 diopters. Similarly, the accommodative power of the lens, crystalline lens at birth is 14 to 16 diopters, whereas this accommodative power reduces to half by the age of 25. As the person becomes 25 years old, the accommodative power of the lens becomes half of the power which was there at birth. And as the person becomes 50 years of age, it further reduces to only 1 to 2 diopters. So that's why a person after the age of 40 years requires the near glasses, because the accommodative power of the person decreases. That's how even a small degree hypermetrope, they don't require glasses because they compensate their near vision with this accommodative. So lens gives about 1/3 of the total diffraction of the eye, as we learned. So these are the nuclear parts. These are the nuclear parts which has got a refractive index of 1.41. This is the equator, as we can see. This is the equator, and these are the poles, and they are posterior poles. So we learned that the equator is 1.375, whereas pole has 1.385. So these equators have power almost equal to cornea. So the refractive index of this area is almost equal to cornea. This has got little higher, but the nucleus has got very high refractive index compared to cornea. And the accommodation means they provide a mechanism of focusing at different distances without movement of the person. It is like zooming of the camera. As we see in a camera, like when there is zoom lens is there, then person need not to move to focus the object or the person at various distances. He just zoom with the camera, and the camera lenses move forward and backward in the zooming position, and the various objects get focused. Similarly, in human eye, the person need not to move to see the various objects at different distances. We can read a book, and simultaneously we can watch TV. So that's how the accommodation works. Optical changes in cataract lenses. Cataract is a very common condition. What are the changes happen during cataract? These small MCQs and as well as short notes has been asked, what are the optical changes of cataract lenses? There will be reduction in the visual acuity. There will be a myopic shift. What do you mean by myopic shift? Means the lens usually have 18 to 22 diopters of power. The power, it will become, the refractive power of the lens increases, and the person becomes myopic. If the cataractous person with a nuclear sclerosis of grade 2 can become myopic of up to 1.5 to 2 diopters. There will be monocular diplopia. Monocular diplopia, because the images formed by the cataractous lens are not in coordination with the image formed by the normal lens. So there will be two images, and the two images are called monocular diplopia. There will be glare because the refractive index and the emission of the water in the crystalline lens produces the diffraction of the light, and there will be a lot of glare. There will be color shift. The normal human light usually absorbs all the shorter wavelengths, especially the blue ray range. That property of the lens decreases as the lens becomes cataract. So these optical changes we have to remember in relation to the crystalline. And the most important and the last component of the eye to focus in the terms of optics is retina. Retina is similar to the film or the card or the digital card what we use in camera. It has got dots and cones. They work as the pixels. The pixels of the camera pixels or the computer. So retina, the optical property of the retina is it has got the maximum resolving power at its fovea. So this part of the retina is called fovea. This is the part which is which present temporal to the optic nerve, optic disc. This is fovea. And the shape of the retina is concave with a radius of minus 12 millimeters. Many a times the students, they get confused. What do you mean by radius of minus 12? We know what is plus 12. We know what is 12. We know what is 15. We know what is 20 millimeter. But what is this minus 12? Why? Because the shape of the retina, if you view from the anterior side, is concave. Because it is concave, so the center of the sphere from which the part of the retina has been cut lies in the negative direction. So that's how the radius of the retina is minus 12 millimeters. Retinal images formed are diagonally inverse, as I shown you in the first slide. The images formed on the retina are diagonally inverse, and macula is the center of image formation. This entire part is called macula. As you can see here, this macula. So this entire portion is macula of the retina, and the center of the macula is fovea. What are the advantages of a curvature of retina, that minus 12 millimeter, the advantage over a film of a camera? As we know, the film of a camera or the card of a camera is flat. It's a flat surface. And the retina is not a flat surface. Retina is a concave, curvatural surface. So what is the advantage of retina over a normal camera? In normal camera, first of all, the field of view is less, and the images formed are not in the right order. What do you mean by images formed in the right order? In the right order means, suppose the order of the inverse image is in the sequence. That time, the flat surface will not give us the advantage of putting all the components of that inverse image in sequence. Whereas retina does that because of its curvature. And a wider field of view can be covered because of the steepness of the retina from a small aperture of the pupil. So after knowing the various components of the eye, and all these, I have to discuss them in relation to the optics of the eye. I have not taken their physiology, I have not taken the pathology of the cornea or retina or crystalline lens. Mainly I have discussed here about the optical aspect of these ocular components. When now we know the major components for the refraction of light is our cornea and crystalline lens. But whenever there are two refracting surfaces, the optics and the calculation become little cumbersome. To understand those parts, how the optics, how the image will be formed, where it will be focused, what will be the size of the image, that all calculation can be done easily if the refracting surface is similar. But in case of human eye, the refracting surfaces are multiple. Single optical system, every optical system, a single optical system has its own pair of cardinal points, three cardinal points. The three cardinal points are focal point, principal point, and nodal. They have a pair, means one system will have three pairs, two system will have six pairs. If these points, they all lie in a single plane, and the value of any two cardinal point pairs are known, then the third pair we can calculate easily. Suppose these are two refracting surfaces, R and R dash. So, and this is an object. AB is considered as an object. In case if these are two refracting surfaces, for this refracting surface, the one set of focal point is F, and the principal point is P, and the nodal point is N. For this refracting surface, the principal point is P dash, nodal point is N dash, and the focal point is F dash. This is for understanding the optic when the light ray falling from an object is going to be focused on. Similarly, the effective outcome of the ray can be calculated in two optical systems by reducing these cardinal points to a single cardinal point. Because if these two cardinal points remain, then the calculation becomes tedious. To simplify the calculation, these multiple cardinal points are reduced to single cardinal point by the theorem given by the great mathematician Gauss. Human eye has got complex multiple optical system, and it behaves like combination of lenses. What I've shown you here in the first slide is, this is the system of a single lens. This system is single lens, one refracting surface, second refracting surface of the same lens, of one lens. Just imagine, in human eye, there are multiple lens system like this. R dash. There are so many of them. Like corneal anterior surface, cornea posterior surface, aqueous, then there is anterior surface of the lens, nucleus of the lens, and the posterior surface of the lens. So that become multiple optical systems. but they behave like combination of them. To resolve this problem, various eye models has been proposed based on the Geisinger curve. These proposed human eye models are called as the proposed Goldstein schematic eye, the Lisping reduced eye, and the Donder simplified. So let us see one by one. Again, these becomes an MCQ questions, and even short notes they ask what are the schematic eyes and reduced eyes. So Goldstein schematic eye has got two focal points, two principal points, and two nodal points. Remember, guys, in Goldstein everything is two. Two focal, two principal, two nodal. As we can see here, this is the first principal, this is the second focal, this is the first principal, this is the second principal. First focal, second focal, P1, P2 principals, and one and two nodal. So there are total 6 points, two focal, two principal, two nodal in Goldstein schematic eye. Goldstein schematic eyes were on a little complicated mathematics, and the distance between all the distances of these points were calculated from the anterior corneal surface. It is anterior surface of cornea, the green line. So all the distances of all these points are technically calculated in the reduced eye, schematic eye, and simplified eye from the anterior surface of cornea. That is the reference point. So from anterior surface of cornea, the F1 is 15.7, F2 is 24.4, P1 is 1.35, P2 is 1.6, N1 is 7.08, the second nodal point is 7.33. These are all values are in millimeters. These all values are in millimeters, mm. Now we come to the second model, schematic model. These are all theoretical models. None of them are practical. These are all theoretical model proposed to understand the focal point, principal point, and nodal point of a human eye. Now, Lisping did what? He kept two focal points, but he reduced two principal points to one and two nodal points to one. Principal point lies somewhere between the cornea and anterior surface of lens, and the nodal point lies somewhere in between the lens. So the Lisping's reduced eye has got two focal points, single principal point, and single nodal point. Now the distances, as we know, F1 and F2, we already know, it remains the same, 15.7 and 24.4 millimeters. However, the distance between the anterior surface of cornea and the principal point is now simplified to 1.5 millimeters. Whereas the distance between the anterior surface of cornea to the nodal point is simplified to 7.2 millimeters. But still, we need to remember four values: 15.7, 1.5, 7.2, and 24.4. So these values were in fraction and difficult to remember. So what Donders did, he further simplified. Although he kept two focal points, single principal point, and single nodal point, but the distances of Lisping's eye, he converted into round figures. He rounded the figures so that we can simply remember them. The distance between principal point and anterior surface is 2 millimeters. And the distance between the nodal and the anterior surface is 5 millimeters. Whereas the distance between F1 and the principal point now is 15 millimeters. Whereas the distance between the second focal point and the principal point is 20 millimeters. Now the figures are simpler to understand. So again, they can ask what are the various distances. But here the reference point for the calculation of focal point distance, distances were principal point. Whereas in the Lisping's eye and even in the, what we can see here, Goldstein's eye. See here, all the distances were calculated from the anterior corneal surface. Here also, and even in this. but Hindi, that these distances were compared from the principal point. As we can see, 2 millimeter, 5 millimeter, anterior 5 15, posterior. So this you have to remember. So the MCQ sometimes they ask this, the distances in which eye is calculated from the principal point, or all the distances are calculated from the anterior surface of the cornea except from the subject. Now the other important aspect of the optics, to understand the optics we should know what are the visual axes. There are simple visual axes, optical axis, visual axis and fixation. What is the optical axis? Optical axis is a line passing from through center of the cornea lens and it meets at retina on the nasal side of fovea. As we can see here, this is the optical axis. It passes from the center of the cornea, center of the lens, center of the rotation, and meets the retina, which is nasal to the focal point or the image formation point of the fovea. Similarly, visual axis is line joining from fixation point, nodal point, and fovea. As we can see, this red color line is a visual axis. Here, it meets the fixation point and meets at the fovea. Similarly, this fixation axis, as we can see, fixation axis is a line joining fixation point and center of rotation. This M is the center of rotation. This is nodal point. This is fovea. So this green part from the fixation point to the center of rotation of the eye is fixation axis. Then these names are there according to the their properties. Fixation axis means between the center of the eye and the fixation point. Visual axis means from where an object will be fall on the fovea. So the fovea comes here. And the optical axis is just a straight line which cuts all the surfaces, refracting surfaces of the eye, like cornea. Now, what are the angles? These angles are sometimes confusing by many of the students when we ask, even for the clinical exam or during the optical refractive exam. Many a times, even a very good student I've heard will not be able to exactly tell what is angle alpha, what is angle gamma, or what is angle kappa. I just simplify this thing and every one of you will understand. Just see this picture. Just see this picture and I'll simplify all these angles like this. One thing we have to remember, to make an angle, there should be two lines. The two lines make an angle. So in all the three angles, one line is fixed. This line is called optical axis, OR. This optical axis is there in all the three angles. So we have to remember what is angle alpha between optical axis and visual axis. But the important point is where this axis is formed. This axis is formed at nodal point. And as we can see here, that this is the nodal point. So the line joining, this red line joining from here to the fovea at nodal point cutting, the angle formed is alpha. This you have to remember the at nodal point. This nodal point is the line. Similarly, when we go to gamma, it is between optical axis and fixation axis, but it is cutting at center. This you have to remember, M, center of rotation. So again, this is fixation axis, green, but at center of rotation. So this is angle gamma. And the third angle is angle kappa. Angle kappa is between optical axis, but a pupillary line. Pupillary line is an imaginary line which cuts at the center of the pupil. And the center of pupil is, all the practical purposes, we consider center of the cornea. Center of the cornea is practically difficult to assess, but when you put a torchlight under the human eye in the primary gauge, the point, central point illuminated is considered as the center of cornea or the center of pupil. So we can see the angle kappa is here. Angle kappa is between this imaginary pupil, that's what's shown in the notes, and at the center of cornea or at the center of pupil against the optical eye. If this is angle kappa, in normal eye, angle kappa is slightly negative, which gives a good visual axis point of view. And the main importance, clinical significance of this angle kappa is in the measurement of degree of deviation or what is called squint or strabismus. So in strabismus or squint, this angle kappa has got significance. When we deal with the squint chapter, that time we will consider the significance of kappa. Now, any optical system is not foolproof. Nothing is foolproof. Similarly, even the human optical system is not foolproof. It has got some defects. So these defects of a normal human eye, these defects doesn't mean that there is a refractive error. No, it won't mean that it's a refractive error. Many students, they confuse optical defects with refractive error. Refractive error is a different thing, and optical defects are physiological of the human eye. They are also called as optical aberrations. So what are the different types of optical aberrations? They are diffraction, spherical aberration, chromatic aberration, decentering, oblique aberration, and comma. This optical defects of the eye is a short note, many a times asked. And you have to remember, many a student, they write refractive error in this short note of optical defects. So optical aberrations are, again, we go diffraction, spherical aberrations, chromatic aberrations, decentering, oblique aberrations, and comma. We'll deal them one by one. What are they? What is diffraction? Diffraction is a simple physics phenomena. When a light ray passes through a small aperture, the rays get diffracted. As you can see this, when this small aperture, these parallel rays, they get diffracted and they become like this. As we see here, when the size of the aperture increases, this, the diffraction, you can see that less obvious. Here it is more obvious because it's more circular. And you see here the aperture is much wider. Once the aperture is much wider, this central portion of the diffraction is similar to the incident. So incident and outcome are almost same. So in general, it means when the size of the aperture increases, the diffraction effect becomes less obvious or it decreases. Because what is the aperture we have in human eye? Human eye, the aperture is pupillary margin or the margins of the pupil. And the second aperture is rim of the crystalline lens. But rim of the crystalline lens don't come unless until the pupil is widely or there is something called an iridia on the surface of the aperture. In that case only the rim of the crystalline lens comes. Otherwise it is mainly the pupillary margin. So in this case, when someone tell me if the pupillary margin is small or it is pinpoint pupil, what will happen to the diffraction? The diffraction will be much obvious. It will be increased. Similarly, when the pupil is dilated or pupil is physiologically dilated, like in the dim light, or pharmacologically dilated by using the midwifery, the diffractions become less. What is the pattern formed by this diffraction is called error disc. The error disc importance is what? Error disc importance is if the size of a 2 millimeter size of pupil, which is considered as a normal lower limit of the pupil size. When the 2 millimeter pupil size is there, the size of the error disc is roughly 0.001 millimeter. So it means what? The pattern which is formed due to the diffracted image contains series of concentric rings. As we can see in this slide, these are all concentric rings here. And these rings, they become wider, wider, wider as the aperture becomes wider. So they have alternate dark and bright lights, along with a bright central disk. You can see this bright central disk. So this bright central disk is called array disk. It has been invented by the scientist Arrhenius. And as I told you, the size of the pupil, the total aperture of the pupil is up to 2 millimeter, then the size of array disk is calculated to the point of 0.1. Now the next abrasion is spherical abrasion. So spherical abrasions, here I just wanted to tell you one more thing about the diffraction. Why, how the human eye compensate for diffraction? Just by increasing or decreasing the size of pupil according to the amount of light. If there is a dim light, the pupil size increases, again the diffraction reduces. And if the light is bright, then the pupil size decreases, again to apply for the diffraction. Similarly, we come to our spherical abrasions. What is spherical abrasions? To understand spherical abrasion, we have to understand the part that the peripheral part of the refracting surface, convexity of the peripheral part of the refracting surface, it can be cornea or it can be lens, it strongly refracts the rays. As we can see that periphery of this refracting surface, these are the peripheral rays and these are the central rays. The peripheral rays shown in red, yellow, green, they are all getting refracted more strongly as compared to the central rays, which are shown in purple, light blue color, which are getting less refracted. So these various amount of refraction, more from the periphery, less from the central, gives a kind of blurring of the image, because the image formed will have from red to the blue. So there will be overlapping. This can give a spherical abrasion. How does the human eye compensate for this spherical abrasion? What are the contributing elements for this reduction of this abrasion? Human cornea is more curved in the center and it is flatter in the periphery. The flatter surface diffracts less. The steeper surface or the curved surface refracts more. So the central portion, as we can see here, the rays falling in this central portion are getting refracted more, whereas these peripheral rays, red, yellow and green, will diffract less. So they all meet at one single point. That's how cornea compensates, being flatter here and steeper in the center. Secondly, the lens. The second refractive surface is lens. The central portion of the lens has got greater density and greater curvature. Means the refractive index of the central portion, as we know, is 1.41, and the curvature also is more in the center compared to the peripheral cortex. That's how, by increasing the density and increasing the curvature on the central part, the lens also compensates for the spherical abrasion. And similarly, the iris. Iris blocks all the peripheral rays. Because the peripheral rays are blocked, so they don't get focused. The only central rays which get focused in a very sharp and a clear focus. That's how the human eye, in a natural mechanism, compensates for the spherical abrasion. Third abrasion is optical defect of the human eye is chromatic abrasion. Chromatic, as the word suggests, chromatic means color. So, as we all know, that white light is the combination of vibgyor, seven colors. So, this vibgyor has got different wavelengths, and we know that the shortest violet color is the shortest, and the red has got the longest wavelength. And the basic law of refraction says that blue ray will refract more as compared to red. Blue in the sense violet, violet, indigo, blue. They will refract more because their wavelength is short. So shorter the wavelength, more the refraction. Longer the wavelength, less the refraction. That's why a white light coming from a bulb or coming from a light source, when it gets refracted through the optical system, the blue rays, they focus in front because they are refracting more powerfully. Whereas the red rays, as you can see here, from the same white light, the red rays, they focus behind because of their longer wavelength. So as we can, these two different focus points of a single white light blue and red gives a kind of blurring of the image. That's what is called as chromatic aberration. But let us see how our human eye deals with this chromatic aberration in a normal condition. See, the long and medium wavelength cones in the eye have very narrow band of spectrum of sensitivity. Means what? The cones present in the retina. The cones present in the retina has got very less sensitivity to longer and medium wavelength. So that's how the cones, blue color wavelength and the red color wave, both blue is medium, whereas red is long. So these blue and red, these both rays are less sensitive for these two rays. The less sensitivity means the less image formation. Whereas, and also the number of the blue cones in fovea is limited. That's how again the blue rays didn't get focused. It is mainly the yellow light which gets focused, because during normal focusing process, the rays having more intensity and a shorter wavelength has got focused well, gets well focused and forms a sharp image on the retina. Whereas the blue light rays of the shorter wavelength and light rays of the longer wavelength forms lower intensity circles as compared to the yellow rays. So the images formed by the red rays or the blue rays are ignored by the visual cortex, and the images what we see is formed only by the yellow wavelength, yellow color wavelength rays. So that's how the human eye compensates for this chromatic aberration. Next optical defect in a human eye is decentering. Decentering means what? As the name suggests, decentering means something is not in center. So what is not in the center? Either it is cornea or it is the lens. What we generally consider is that lens is not in the center. As we can see in this picture, the lens is not in alignment with the line OA. OA is that this optical line. It is not the lens. The center of the lens is not aligned. Corneal center of curvature is situated about 0.25 millimeters below the axis of the lens, or inversely, what we can say is the center of the lens is nearly a quarter millimeter above the cornea center. But because this decentration of these two refracting surfaces is very less, very minimal, so the clinically light rays don't get much importance. It won't hamper the focusing of the object to the retina. So that's why there is no compensatory mechanism available, and even this decentering can be clinically inconclusive. Next aberration is oblique aberration. What is oblique aberration? It is again produced by the periphery. And the object is in the peripheral visual field. If the suppose the object is in the central visual field or in them straight, nothing to worry. Because the central field is well focused, so the image form is well sharp, clear, and we can see that easily. But when the image object is in the periphery of your visual, that time the incident rays from that object forms a pencil of rays when they enter the eye. This pencil of rays will produce a kind of Strum's conoid phenomenon, and two focal lines are formed, as we can see in this picture. These two rays are from, when the rays are from the center, if the object is situated in this area, nothing to worry, they will focus properly. But if the object is situated somewhere here, then the rays arising from the object will form a ray of pencil. So there will be two focal points, FA and FB. This produces a kind of Strum's conoid phenomenon. It is seen significantly in biconcave, convex or biconcave lenses, and meniscus lenses or periscopic lenses. They reduces the oblique aberration phenomenon. Means when we use biconvex or biconcave lenses for optical glasses or the chasm or the spectacle, at that time the peripheral rays in those lenses will produce the oblique aberration. And to reduce this oblique aberration in spectacle lenses, the normally waterproofing beer spectacle or the glass lens. Those lenses are made meniscus form or in a periscopic form to reduce the peripheral oblique abrasion in case the refractive error of that person is quite high. As we can see here, these meniscus lenses, even the peripheral lens are focused at a single point of lens, central and peripheral. Both are getting. How does human eye and normally compensate for this spherical angle or this oblique abrasion, which is coming from the peripheral? So how is it compensated? It is minimum in human eyes because the curvature of retina, again, the curvature of retina, which is adapted to the optical system of eye in such a manner that the peripheral visual field of eye is not affected practically. I told you before what are the advantages of curvature of retina against the flat surface of camera film, wider field, and the images they form in a proper sequence. They are well adjusted and well seen. Similarly, the another advantage of curvature of retina here is that the peripheral visual field of the eye is not practically adopted by the human visual cortex. Similarly, another factor is pupil. Pupil also, by changing the size of pupil, the amount of pencil rays reached to the retina are reduced. So these two factors, curvature of the retina and the size of the pupil, they control this oblique abrasion in a normal human eye. The last abrasion or the optical abrasion is comma. So what do we understand by comma? Comma is like simple comma, what we use in the sentences, as we can see that they have applied commas here, but there are so many commas. So it is something like that, a similar comma, what we use in English. The images formed are like a comma. Comma means, comma has got a head, a round head, and then a tail, small tail. Similar to comma, this comma aberration is there. What how this comma aberration arises in a normal human optical system? As we can see in the diagram, as we can see in this picture, this is the light source. Various rays are generating from this light source and they are incidenting on different planes of the refracting surface. So different areas of the lens, it forms different focusing planes. As you can see from this point, that this ray and this last, this is the periphery of the lens. This is again the periphery of the lens. These two periphery of the lens, orange color, is forming a large clear focus here. Similarly, these two green color is in the middle portion of the lens, is forming an image next to this brighter image, another image here. Similarly, the central portion of the lens, red color shown, is forming another. So as we can see that there are three focuses from the peripheral, middle, and the central portion of a single refracting surface from a point source through a lens. It means that the different areas of lens form foci in planes other than the chief focus from a point source of light. It means point source of light forms the chief focus along with an imaginary plane of multiple foci. This effect of imaginary plane, multiple focus formation, is termed as comma. Comma is reduced by preventing the entry of peripheral rays refracting from the ocular surface. How this comma is? Comma is basically which lead to so many other abrasions. Comma is the beginning of the second order abrasion, and comma reduces by preventing the entry. As I told you, entry of the peripheral rays are prevented out by the size of the pupil, by the curvature of the retina. The peripheral entry of the peripheral rays are prevented and the comma aberration is prevented. So thank you guys. for listening patiently about this basic topic, which is the most important and the foundation of the entire ophthalmology, to understand the eye as an optical instrument. If you have any queries related to the optical system or the human eye optics or the refraction, refracting error, the refraction, you can put up your questions. So your questions are welcome.